You're listening to the Unwritable Rant Podcast with your host, author, and occasional misanthrope, Juliette Miranda. Go to theunwritablerant.com and you can subscribe on iTunes or connect with the show on Facebook and Twitter.
Hey there, y'all. This is Juliette Miranda. Welcome to episode number 64 of the Unwritable Rant Podcast. Y'all, it is bourbon time here in the Rant Studio. And I don't know about the rest of you, but I am ready to start drinking, so do not make a girl wait. Get your glass, fill it up, and it is time to toast. Cheers, y'all. Oh, y'all, I am drinking what is quite possibly the best bourbon I have ever had. And I do not say that lightly. I've had some fine bourbons. This one is outstanding. Y'all, today I am drinking Orphan Barrel Rhetoric. It is a whiskey that has been aged 22 years. Now, the folks over at Orphan Barrel, apparently they rescue lost and rare barrels of whiskey from forgotten rickhouses. I don't know how true that is, but I can tell you that this 22-year whiskey is outstanding. It is incredible. Now, you know that aged bourbons and whiskeys can be a little bit of a risk because you never really know what's going to happen to that flavor profile when it ages and soaks up all of that wood and all of that moisture and atmosphere. But with this Orphan Barrel Rhetoric, the result is mind-blowing. Your first sip tastes like leather. And then it opens up a little bit and you get that sort of dried fruit flavor to it. And then you roll it around in your mouth a little bit and you taste a bit of dark chocolate. And it finishes off with just a hint of smoke. It tastes like old books. That is the best way I can describe it. And hopefully that sounds appealing to you because to me, this is absolute heaven. I am going to be fawning all over this whiskey for the entire show. But I'll tell you, this whiskey makes so much sense to me. Unlike certain things like, I'm going to say it, the Three Stooges. Are y'all Three Stooges fans? Because here's the thing. My guy is, and I am not. Now, that's not to say I don't love good comedy. I'm just a Cheech and Chong kind of girl. A Beavis and Butthead fan, if you will. Comedy, to me, comes in duos, not trios. And as far as I'm concerned, that makes the Three Stooges the most unfunny entity on the planet, falling just shy of that movie, Nothing But Trouble. But I'll tell you, I feel like I'm missing out on something by not appreciating the Three Stooges. And I can see it in my guy's eyes every time he talks about them, and I get that blank, glazed expression on my face. I want to like them, if not for myself, then for my guy, who loves the Three Stooges. So we were sitting in our driveway, drinking, of course, on the last warm weekend in Chicago. And I said, explain them to me. Tell me what makes them so funny. Well, my guy did his best, but of course it's impossible to break down what makes good comedy. His basic concept is that the Three Stooges are all about the reaction shots. According to my guy, it's the subtleties, not the slapstick, that's funny. Really? I don't know. I fail to see the subtlety in yanking the toupee off somebody, dropping it on Mo or Shemp, I don't know who's who, and then the ensuing riot when someone yells tarantula. Why is that funny? How is that subtle? And I said this to my guy, and he looks at me with this expression that just says, you were so close to being the perfect woman. So he tried a different tactic to explain this to me, and he asks if I recalled my crazy glue incident. God damn his memory. Of course I remembered it. And I didn't need him to recall it for me, but he did because it's one of his favorite stories. You see, at the core of this story, I am not as graceful as I would like, particularly at 6 o'clock in the morning when I am attempting to feed my cat in the dark. So I'm knocking around the kitchen, bashing into things, stepping on things, and I accidentally knock my favorite mug onto the floor. Fortunately, it wasn't too damaged, just the handle broke off. But I love this mug. And in my irrational little girl brain at 6 o'clock in the morning, I had to fix it. Because my day just wasn't going to be right if I couldn't drink my tea out of it. So it's at about 6:12 a.m. when I pulled the crazy glue out of its little safety container. And the warnings on that container really should have included something like, if you have just woken up and not turned the lights on, do not use this product. If you are still half asleep and you haven't had any caffeine, do not use this product. Of course, my eyes were so bleary, I probably wouldn't have read that anyway. So what the hell? Here I am using crazy glue at 6:12 in the morning. So I've got the little tube between my thumb and my index finger, and I'm attempting to squeeze a few drops under the coffee mug handle. And by 6:18 in the morning, I'm still squeezing the little tube, waiting for something, anything to come out of it. Now, there was glue in the container, that much I was certain of, because I could smell it. It was that noxious octane sort of smell, and it's wafting from my fingers to my nose in a vile stream. So I'm thinking, well, gee, it must be working. So I squeezed the tube a little bit tighter. Now, what exactly I thought was working is beyond me, particularly when the mechanics of a tube of glue are kind of simple. But I kept squeezing away like a moron, letting my thoughts drift to other things like shiny objects and bouncy balls and rainbows. At 6:21 in the morning, I realized my fingers were stuck to the crazy glue tube. You see that smell? It came from the glue that had oozed from a hole in the side of the tube, and it drizzled this fine web from my fingertips to a little pool on the countertop. It took me a couple of beats to realize what had happened, that I had created some sort of great glue slick on my countertop between me and my fingers and the glue tube, which is stuck to my fingers. And I'm trying to pry them loose, yanking at them, but it causes pain, and I don't want pain, so I'm freaking out a little bit. Now, any normal person would just, you know, head to the nearest source of warm, soapy water, for instance, but me, being ultra clever and astute, I had a better idea. Paper towels. Paper towels to clean up glue. So I'm thinking, right, if I can just scrub the glue from my fingers, it'll be fine. And I gotta get that glue slick off the counter too, right? So I'll kill two birds with one stone. I reach across the counter, I pull a few sheets off the roll. Never mind the glue still on my fingers, which were still glued to the tube. And the funny thing, of course, glue doesn't wipe up so well, particularly of the crazy variety. So as I'm dragging my mass of paper towels across the countertop, it kind of congeals into this fuzzy, hardened mass. And I'm forced to rip paper towels from my fingertips now, which, mind you, of course, are still glued to the crazy glue tube. And it's at 6:26 a.m. when I panicked. I began pacing around the kitchen in a frenzy. I mean, I'm waving my arms around. I'm trying to figure out what to do next. And as I'm doing this irrational little glue dance, my hair is falling in my face and my robe is slipping off my shoulder. So I'm trying to like get myself together. And I brush my hand across my face like a dimwit because I did it with the glue hand, which, of course, if you will recall, still had a crazy glue tube stuck to it. Yeah, it was my scream that woke my guy up out of a dead sleep, and he found me in the kitchen with a tube of glue cemented to my fingers, which are now tangled up in my hair. Never mind, of course, the wad of paper towels that would need to be chiseled from the countertop. Well, it certainly wasn't my finest moment, and I don't really think my guy knew what to do first, soothe me or laugh. And of course, he made the wrong goddamn choice. Now, through all of his obnoxious laughter at the situation that was so not funny, my guy composes himself long enough to extract some quick damage control. So I answered his questions. No, I hadn't eaten any glue. No, I didn't inhale any either. And no, for the love of God, there was nothing with a pulse stuck to me. Well, by about 6:36 in the morning, we were minus one bottle of nail polish remover, a tube of crazy glue, and most of my dignity, but the good news is we managed to repair my mug. Now, of course, I could only pray that no one lit a match near me, but I was otherwise fine. Now, my guy, of course, is recalling this event as the most hysterical escapade full of great reaction shots that anybody would love to laugh at. Oh, you should have seen your face, he's saying. That's classic funny. Well, my guy was so caught up in telling his oh-so-hilarious story that he managed to forget we had the grill going. Because, like I mentioned, it was the last sunny day in Chicago, and, well, we wanted to take full advantage of it. It was the black plumes of smoke that clued us in that we had forgotten about the grill and something wasn't quite right with it. So my guy lifts it up and is greeted by an immediate fireball. It turns out the plank that we were grilling our seafood on had caught fire and turned into a blazing inferno, charring everything, including our seafood dinner. Now, this thing is blazing, right? And my guy's got to do something with it. And here's the thing, you know, when you're caught up in a tense situation like that, people can react in many different ways. Some are calm and rational and calculated. And then there was my guy, who grabs his barbecue tongs and yanks the flaming plank out of the grill and starts dancing around with it. Well, it's seriously on fire. He doesn't know what to do with it, so he drops it in a pile of wood chips next to the house. I am on the ground laughing because he doesn't know what to do now, so he just reacts and he grabs the first thing he sees because he wants to douse the fire. Except for the fact that he grabbed my tumbler full of bourbon and splashed it onto that flame, just igniting it up even further and nearly burning off all of his eyebrows and hair on his arms. Oh, I am on the ground laughing my ass off. And as he is slapping at the fire with his goddamn flip-flop, he looks at me as if to say, "What? What is so fucking funny?" And all I could do is catch my breath and look at him and say, "I get it, baby. I get it. It's all in the reaction." I'm gonna have a little bit more of my bourbon. Hang on, y'all. Oh, that is the greatest bourbon ever. I don't know how many bottles there are available of this Orphan Barrel Rhetoric in the world. Apparently it's rare. I don't know. But if you find it, just get it. Don't think, just get. So in thinking about all the great reaction shots I've seen in my life, I'm reminded of one that may not necessarily be as funny, but it certainly was satisfying. A while back, my guy and I decided we were going to take one of our notorious road trips and wound up at a casino in the middle of the Midwest. Now, I'm going to be deliberately vague in describing this casino because, well, knowing my guy and I, of course, we found trouble there. I gotta say, I love Midwest casinos. They're absolutely nothing like Las Vegas. I mean, not at all. Though they certainly try. They get it all jazzed up and there's blinking lights and flashing and music and all of that, but despite all of the epileptic frills of these Midwest casinos, they still kind of reek of a tragic sort of hope. Like everybody's just reaching a little too hard for something that's right out of their grasp. Personally, I find these casinos to be a riot. You never know what you're going to see at them. Now, this particular casino had a hotel attached to it, so we were there for the weekend, my guy and I, and we were able to head on into the casino fairly early because we knew what we wanted to do. So we walk in and we do a lap, get a cocktail, and we see exactly what we want. Two open seats at the three-card poker table. I'm fairly certain I have raved about how much I adore three-card poker before, but I'm going to do it again because as far as I'm concerned, this is the greatest casino game there is. I know some of y'all will argue with me and say that blackjack is the best game ever, and you could be right. I have no doubt that it's very likely blackjack has better odds and pays out better than three-card poker. But for me, it requires way too much concentration, because I'm just not a numbers girl. I don't add real well. I don't keep track of numbers real well. And I certainly don't want the responsibility of not fucking up somebody else's hand who's sitting next to me. It's just too much. I don't want that pressure on me. I just want to kick back and enjoy the game. That's why three-card poker is so perfect. You know, it's just you against the dealer. You get three cards. Whoever has the better hand wins. Everybody at the table can be friends. We can all hang out and drink. It's ideal for drinkers. Well, we get situated at the table and we're playing a couple of hands, but it's kind of subdued. Nobody's really winning at the table. And the dealer is kind of killing the mood. Now, not really through anything that he said or did, but some dealers are like that. They just have this weird vibe. And I suppose it's superstitious on my part to not trust them, but that's just how it rolls. So my guy and I are like, all right, you know what? Let's play out this hand and change tables. But what do you know? That dealer's shift is ending and they're bringing in a new guy. Well, I don't think too much about it. You know, they're doing the little clap, clap, shake your hands over the table, nothing up the sleeve routine. but I catch the eye of the new dealer and I realize I know him. And as he looks at me, he obviously realizes that he knows me too. Y'all, I was staring right into the face of the jackass. You may remember the jackass as the guy I dated back in my early 20s who took me to a strip club for my birthday and abandoned me there. And then later was sniffing spilled cocaine out of the threads of his apartment carpeting. He's also the same guy that I went to Jamaica with and wound up getting so incredibly annoyed with, I flung a jellyfish at his head while I was raging on mushrooms. That is the jackass. I hadn't seen him in decades. And quite honestly, I didn't expect to see him ever again unless it was on the evening news being led away in handcuffs. And I'm looking at him wondering how in the hell he got a job in a casino at all, because I'll tell you, the jackass, in addition to being a drummer and a rampant recreational drug user, he was also a compulsive gambler. I know, wasn't he a winner? I was immediately taken back to the moment when I realized just how awful of a gambler he was. Now, this is going back to the way, way early days of our relationship. And I was at his home and we were in his spare bedroom, which he also used as a drum studio. And I was helping him redecorate, if you will. We were stapling empty egg cartons onto his wall because he was too cheap to buy soundproofing. And as we're doing this little home improvement project, somebody starts banging on his front door. And by banging, I don't mean just a, you know, kind of knock, 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 let me in. I mean somebody beating the hell out of his front door with a baseball bat, hurling threats through the wood. It scared the crap out of me and Jackass. I've never seen him get so quiet so fast. Well, I immediately think we should call the police, but then he explains the situation to me. Yeah, the guy at the door was his bookie. A couple of weeks back, Jackass had bet on some college football game and lost his ass to that guy. And now he wanted to collect. Well, this guy is still pounding on the door like a maniac. And Jackass looks at me, ever the gentleman, of course, and says, "Why don't you get it?" "Oh, sure, sure. I'll get the door and get my ass kicked. Great idea, buddy." I had never dealt with a bookie before, but I was pretty confident that he already knew Jackass was in the house and he wasn't going to go anywhere until he got to him. And if he had to go through me, I'm sure he would have. So I asked Jackass, what's going to make him go away? And that's when he looks at me and says, "How much money do you have on you?" As it was, I actually had a fair amount of cash on me. I had just started working a job where I was paid fairly well, and I had planned on going shopping after spending some time with Jackass that day. I'm going to admit something to you that I am not proud of at all. And the only thing that I can say in my defense is that I was still at the point in the relationship where I had affection for Jackass, where I still liked him and wanted him to like me. God knows why. I should have run out of that room the second he suggested we staple egg cartons to the wall. But that's where I was. So I reached into my purse and I gave him about $300 in cash. And I'm thinking about all of this right then and there as I am looking at Jackass shuffling a deck of cards and wondering how in the hell we ever got to this position. Well, my guy senses a change in me, of course, and he leans over and he's like, "What's going on with you?" So I tell him, "That's Jackass." Well, my guy immediately goes into protection mode. He's like, "Are you okay? Do we need to leave the table? Is there something I need to do about this?" It would have been very easy to get up from the table. But I'm thinking, you know what? Right now, I am a reasonably intelligent woman. I'm confident. I'm not going to let Jackass scare me away from a 3-card poker table. Fuck that. So I tell my guy, "You know what? Let's stay and see what happens." Now, my guy is not one to sit by quietly when there is someone standing in front of me who has done me wrong. So he gets that look on his face, the one I know oh so well. Now, to anybody who doesn't know my guy, they see that look and they think it is pure, sweet innocence. But I know better. I know it is hiding a black, black plan of darkness. So he leans in and squints at Jackass's name tag as if he doesn't already know who he is. And he says, "Excuse me, Jackass. Would you mind calling the waitress for us? My wife and I here are very thirsty, and we would love to order some cocktails. In fact, we're having a great night, and we'd like to order cocktails for everybody at the table. Well, that elicits a whole round of cheers from the table, and I see Jackass's smile tighten. He's not pleased with having to call the waitress over and do our bidding, but he has no choice in the matter. So he does as he's told, and he starts dealing out our cards. Well, I will tell y'all that for as lousy of a gambler as Jackass was, he was a really good dealer. And by good, I mean he dealt everybody at the table a winning hand. And he continued to do so for a good 5 rounds. And every time he turned over my guy's winning hand, my guy would look at him and go, "Winner, pay me." And of course, Jackass would have no choice but to slide over another pile of chips to my guy. And that kept going with every hand. "Winner, pay me." Another hand goes by, my guy says, "Call the waitress over. We'd like some more cocktails, please." "Winner, pay me." It was as if fate had smiled down upon us that night and graced us with the greatest hands on the planet. Now, we knew our good luck wasn't going to last forever, so I give my guy the universal let's wrap it up kind of look. And he agrees and looks at Jackass and says, "Could you color us up, please? We've had enough winning for the night." And Jackass is seething. I can hear him gritting his teeth together as he's counting out our chips, sliding them over and glaring at us. Well, my guy and I get up from the table, and I see my guy, out of habit, reach for a couple of chips to tip the dealer. But I put my hand over my guy's, and I say, "You know what? I don't think that'll be necessary tonight." And then I look over at Jackass, smile at him with my own angelic little smile, and I say, "I'd say we're about even, wouldn't you?" Well, my guy and I spent the rest of the night at the bar, drinking some lovely whiskey and tipping the hell out of our bartender, because when you have that kind of good fortune, you always pay it forward. Well, I'd say y'all have heard enough from me for one episode. Now remember, just go to theunwritablerant.com if you want to catch up on any of the back episodes or check out Jackass's old story. As well, you'll find all the different ways you could subscribe to The Unwritable Rant, like iTunes and Stitcher and iHeartRadio and all the fine other places that support podcasts like this one. In the meantime, I am going to suck back a whole lot more bourbon. I hope you all have a great week. I will be back talking with you again next Sunday. Cheers, y'all.